was sin. Sin is everywhere, in and out. The second sign is materialism on the expense of spirituality. In the three stages, you will see people are very materialistic. Tell me, what is your net worth? How much you own, how much you're worth? I don't care, you pray, you don't pray, huh? Tell me, what's your position? What's your zip code, the address of, zip code of your address? What car you are driving? This is all goes into materialism. During the time of Noah, he said in Luke 17, they ate, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. During Lot, likewise, as it was also in the days of Lot, they ate, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they built. They are all after earthly life. And before the second coming of the Lord and send his servant to at supper time to say to those who were invited, come, for all things are now ready, but they all with one accord began to make excuses. There is a long list of excuses, but when you get a call from God to pray or to repent or to change your life or to prepare yourself for eternity, you always pops up with excuse. I will not read the excuses mentioned in the Gospel of Luke. I want you to dig in your life and find out what kind of excuse you give God not to follow him and not to prepare yourself. So the first thing is spread of sin. The second thing is materialism. Easy measure for your life, if you are spiritual or materialistic, how many minutes you spend for your spiritual life and how many hours you spend in your life for whatever it takes you. The third thing, or the third character, is lack of faith and disobedience of God's commandment. And this was very clear. Noah talked to them and they refused. Lot talked to them, I don't want to read more verses, there are so many, and they refused. And in the second coming, it will be the same. I will just read what St. Peter said. Knowing this first, that scoffers will come in the last days, walking according to their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. So we look very shortly and we say there is nothing. He answered this question. If you want to keep reading, St. Peter, 2nd Epistle, St. Peter, chapter 3. The fourth character for the coming, that few will be saved and many will be destroyed. How many saved during the time of Noah? How many? Eight. Just eight. And from Sodom and Gomorrah, how many saved? Three. How many will be saved in his second coming? Are you one of them? Take it serious, huh? You know, when there is a big event and they tell you there is limited seats, huh? First come, first serve, huh? And the fifth character is a surprise. It was a surprise at all levels. And Jesus, when he talked about the signs of his second coming, he gave us what to do. And he told us one word, be what? Watchful, be watchful. And yesterday, my beloved youth and children, they told me, what does it mean to be watchful? Continuous repentance, or in a church wording, life of repentance. I always keep judging myself. We judge people, we condemn people. We point fingers on people, but you need to start by judging yourself. Continuous repentance is continuous cleaning. Nothing to prevent me from entering the kingdom of God. Nothing to prevent me from hearing his voice, well done, servant. And definitely, the other, remember what last time we talked about the spiritual vital signs, the five things, which is prayers, fasting, Bible, confession, and communion. Measure those in your life. And I'm talking to every father here and every mother. Measure it in your life. Measure it in the life of your kids. The church focused on the second coming of the Lord. That's why there is something we do. I hope you draw attention to it. We recite the greet in every prayer, right? Did you ask yourself why we recite the greet as a statement, fact? We believe in one God, God the Father, the heaven, and so on, till we come to the end and start to do what? Sing, right? Right? You notice this? Did you ask yourself why? Why we mention all the greet as a statement of faith? And when we come to this part, we look for the resurrection of the dead and the, we sing it. Why we sing it? Why? Why the church asked us to sing this part? Because whatever we mention is fact. This part is coming. And the church wanna draw your attention. Sometimes you can recite this creed and you are just sleepy. But when you start to sing, you participate. Can we sing this part together? We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the Are you serious? Are you serious? You are looking for the coming of the Lord, the next age to come? Really? If God calls any one of us now, he will be okay. You just ask it for it. Right? We are looking for it. This is everybody recite. But in the liturgy, the church focus on this also. In the church, after the institutions, there is a part called anamnesis. Okay? Anamnesis is a living proclamation of Jesus' death and resurrection and remembrance of him until his coming. This comes before the epiclesis. In this part, the priest will pray about the second coming of the Lord. When he says in San Basil's liturgy, and his second coming, which shall be from the heavens, awesome and full of glory. You remember hearing this? It's more elaborate in Saint Cyril liturgy. The priest will say, and look for his second advent, coming from the heavens, awesome and full of glory at the end of this age, wherein he comes to judge the world in righteousness and to give each one according to his deeds, whether they be good or evil. I think this is a very clear statement. What the people's response will be. You remember what you used to say when you hear this part, either or in Basil or Cyril? According to your mercy, O Lord, and not according to our sins. And this is what makes us have hope to stand before the throne of God. According, that's why the church kept using this, have mercy, have mercy, have mercy. And in this part especially, you see also this difference. Each part in the liturgy, the response either Amen or Lord have mercy. But this part, when we talk about his second coming, we say according to your mercy, O Lord, and not according to our sins. So when we pray, I want you to pay attention to this part. And when you sing the last part of the creed, I want you to pay attention to this part and ask yourself this question always. I'm prepared. I'm ready. He can come or we can go. We don't know which one will happen first. And it is not related to anything. I remember a nice guy sent to Bob Shinoda a question that he had a dream that he will die after 20 years. And he's kind of shaked. So the Bob told him, you give us a lot of great information that the second coming will not happen before 20 years, for example. And the devil used this technique before with people to mislead them. If I live 20 years, then I can mess up a little bit and repent. So this is definitely not from God. I wanted this to be always in front of your eyes, my beloved. One of the monks, when he was departing, they found him crying. And they asked him, why you are crying? What was you afraid from? He told them, since I start my monastic life, I kept three situations in front of my eyes, always thinking of them. When my spirit departs my body, and this refers to the angels will accompany him or the devils, the minute I will be brought before the throne of God, and the third one is when I hear the judgment of God on me. Any one of us think about those three situations? Huh? We sign papers, for example, for CPR and medical support and all of this, but we don't prepare ourselves for this time, which for sure is coming. I'm telling this to myself before you. It's for sure is coming. Remember the minute you depart the body, remember when you are before God, and remember when you hear the judgment of God, hopefully it will be well done, servant. Well done, servant. And glory be to God forever. Amen.